In the 21st century, terrorists and rogue nations use unimaginably sophisticated computer codes to send messages, forcing American spies to work from the murky world of cyberspace to foil their evil plots before it's too late.
We're no longer looking at an enemy in uniform. Now it's really in the shadows of people recruiting in their own homeland to turn against their own government.
This seems like an entirely new form of warfare, but our high-tech battle with enemies of the state has historical origins, rooted in the very beginnings of the Republic. 100 years ago, American code warriors worked from a headquarters disguised by a New York City front organization.
It was here that Herbert O. Yardley ran America's Black Chamber, a precursor to today's National Security Agency.
In World War II, Allied code breaking changed the course of history.
Intelligence gathering and decryption efforts shortened that conflict by at least 2 full years.
And during the Cold War, globe-trotting spies cracked Soviet ciphers.
It's possible that this is one of the greatest intelligence coups of the 20th century.
But today, how can American codebreakers match wits with enemies who've perfected the dark art of high-tech tradecraft?
The technology is going to keep evolving, we'll keep having these problems, and we'll keep solving these problems.
Now, inside America's Secret Code Wars. From the very founding of the United States, diplomats and traders, soldiers and spies have used codes to hide the contents of secret messages.
We had code breakers during the Revolutionary War, during the Civil War, and during many other conflicts that this nation was engaged in. But at the end of these conflicts, they always went back to their jobs, as farmers, as lawyers, as teachers.
These early code makers often use simple substitution ciphers, which replace one letter with another letter or symbol. But all this changes in the 20th century.
In modern warfare, such as in World War II, messages are often passed by radio, and then they're easy to intercept. Everybody's got the messages. So encryption is now more important than ever.
This is why nations start using sophisticated cipher machines and begin to employ code breakers even during peacetime. Over the next century, these devices scramble secret messages in increasingly complex ways. Today, rogue nations and terrorists use tiny consumer devices that can offer far better encryption than any code machine used in World War II.
It's really good. Now everyone's sort of on the same platform. And the question then becomes, well, how do we get into that global platform to ensure that we can monitor whoever we need to monitor?
Today, America's digital spies decrypt more sophisticated codes coming from more sources than ever before. But they rarely emerge from the shadows. And when they do, it's only for a moment. One of those times may have been the evening of May 3rd, 2015. The Dallas suburb of Garland, Texas, is hosting a controversial community event. A contest to see who can draw the best cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad. This gathering is a beacon for Islamic terrorists because Muslims forbid depictions of the Prophet.
There were two individuals who were outraged by this cartoon contest and decided that they were going to attack people at the place where it was being held. So wearing body armor and armed with guns, they went out with the intention of killing as many people as they could.
The two terrorists, Elton Simpson and Nadir Sufi, drive to the event, jump out of their car near a police barricade, and open fire. But the authorities are ready.
When they came out with their guns drawn, we had one very well-trained, very alert police officer who was able to neutralize them before there was any further damage.
There was a shootout and both the gunmen were killed.
But did law enforcement stop the attack simply because of an alert officer, or did the feds have advanced knowledge? The FBI alerted local police about Simpson 3 hours before he arrived at the event. How could they know about the impending attack before it occurred? Are the details of this terrorist attack still hidden behind a layer of deception?
Eldon Simpson had actually been on the radar of U.S. law enforcement officials before the Garland shooting, who suspected him of trying to go join the ranks of ISIS overseas and suspected him of having ties to them. We're never able to completely prove it, but did have him under surveillance because of these suspicions.
Is it possible that federal agents were surreptitiously reading private emails Simpson sent about the attack before it occurred? And if so, do the feds deny this because they don't want their enemies to know how they work?
I think it's entirely possible the FBI was also looking at his private Twitter messages, the direct messages, prior to the shooting. We don't know for sure, but I think we have to suspect that someone who was under that kind of surveillance, the FBI might have access to those communications as well.
This would sound like the improbable plot of a Hollywood thriller, if not for the extraordinary cache of documents leaked by former National Security Agency contractor Edward Snowden.
He revealed things about the NSA tapping into corporations like Facebook and Google and Microsoft, getting communications from those companies with a lawful order, it should be noted. But really this vast sort of global architecture of surveillance existed.
Revelations of this secret surveillance operation have created a rift between technology companies that don't want their programs hacked and the government that says it needs access. The debate rages on, but it's not the first time the issue has flared. In fact, a remarkably similar dispute dogged America's first permanent code-breaking organization when it opened its doors 100 years ago.